Good afternoon. I'm obviously not Amir. Amir is a colleague from Egypt, and he was recently got a new job in Qatar, which made it impossible for him to come here. So he very recently sent me this presentation, and I will do my best to present it. So this is a well-known picture about the pools. I won't go through all of them, but as you can see, Egypt is a bit on the borderline of two pools, pool 3 and pool 4. And in recent years, a lot of activities have been deployed in Egypt, and surveillance has been improved very much. So we know much more about the viruses that are circulating and that are being introduced. And as you can see, the first one, that is a Sharkia 72 virus. I would skip it from the list because I think it's a laboratory contamination and it keeps coming back. But the other ones, they are true introductions. And the Africa G7 virus, for example, gave a big epidemic in 2006 and continued to circulate for some time. The Pan-Asia 2 strain we have seen for some time in Egypt, and the Iran 05 is still circulating. And then in 2012, we had a big epidemic of Z2 in Egypt. Nowadays, we find a lot of the O East Africa 3 strains. So the main message is that for the moment, and it can change any day, of course, that the patterns in Egypt are a bit different from the rest of North Africa, if you like. In Egypt, they import a lot of cattle from Africa, and they come by ship, and they go through Djibouti and the Red Sea, and then they go to Alexandria. And I always say viruses travel with animals, preferentially. Don't look for the unobvious things, look for the obvious transmissions. And other introductions like O India 2001 have not happened in Egypt, for example. And they happened in Libya, and they spread from Libya westwards, but not eastwards. And there is a big desert in between anyway, but apparently, or maybe, there's also hardly any import of cattle from Libya, in contrary to the imports that are happening from Africa. And now, since 2012, we have seen several introductions from another A, Africa, genotype 4. Well, this is a well-known picture about the genome of FMD and the variable VP1 region, which is used for isolate characterization, and the conserved regions, and we just heard the story about the 3D and the 5' UTR, which are used for the PEN serotype, the PEN FMD assays. What Amir has been doing, and he's also working on real-time PCRs, and there has been collaboration with Purbright already for specific real-time PCRs, like for the SET2 2012 viruses. But for this presentation, he wants to demonstrate that he has developed a conventional multiplex PCR to serotype AO and Z2, as we know them, that should cover at least all the strains that we nowadays see in Egypt. Because it is a conventional PCR and you want to discriminate on a gel, of course, there should be a size difference. And these are the sizes of the fragments that he has developed. And RNA extraction was done with the Dynabeads nucleic acid kit. Samples were screened with the PEN-FMD test described by Reed, real-time PCR, and he has done a little bit on assay validation. To check specificity and or cross-reactivity, archival samples representing the strains that I just mentioned have been tested, except for the G7 strain. He didn't have that at hand. He has tested, of course, his primers in silico, and there was a complete match with the viruses from 2006 and 2009, but he didn't test it in real. He tested some negative samples, and he tested like 45 clinical and tissue culture samples that were tested in parallel by Intergen ELISA and by this assay. And he, for all the samples that scored positive, he has done nucleotide sequencing of the amplified products, and he has determined the limit of detection. Well, this is how it looks like. This is a mixed, This is the fragment that you could expect for type A viruses. This should be the SET2 viruses, and these are the O viruses. Well, personally, I think this is a bit close to each other, so maybe the gel can be run a little bit longer, but anyway, the difference is clear, and this is a mixed sample where you have all the three of them. Here you see another example for the A, the Z2 and the O. Here are some of the samples that he tested from the archives, where you can see that the O-Sharkia 72 virus, this laboratory contaminant, as I call it, scored positive. The OEA3 virus, which are currently very dominant in Egypt, scored positive, and the OPanAsia viruses, they also scored positive. And also the viruses O, Equine, East Africa 3, 2014 scored positive. The Z2 here, which was a weak positive sample anyway, but they have also strong positive results. And then type A viruses like ARANO5, and here a mixed sample with A and O. Here again an ARANO5, OEA3, 2016. The A Africa G4, which has recently in a shipment to Purbright, has been detected again, and the SAT2 Alexandria 2012 virus. Now these are the negative samples and the positive control. Fortunately, they're all negative. And this is like dilution series of a DNA construct in the serotype O assay and in the SAT2 assay. And in the A assay, and don't ask me about the absolute numbers because I didn't get a good explanation about the concentration of the initial product. So the conclusions and the recommendations are that this developed multiplex RT-PCR assay differentiates accurately between AO and Z2 in Egypt, and it will save cost, time and effort. And you can ask yourself, of course, why a conventional PCR. Nowadays, with everybody doing real-time PCR, and also in Egypt, they have their real-time PCR equipment. ELISA, I will come back to that one also. Well, one of the issues, and I've discussed that with Labib, and Labib has deliberately developed in collaboration with countries in West Africa, also a conventional multiplex PCR, is that it is much cheaper. Of course, I love also real-time PCR, but when labor is cheap and reagents are expensive, it's not always the best situation. Yeah, so for some countries, conventional PCR can really be much cheaper in terms of exploitation. The 45 samples, he didn't make a table out of that, but I got it on my cell phone from him. So the 45 samples that he tested in parallel, in fact, half of them were antigen ELISA positive. Yeah, I should state it a little bit differently. They were all PEN-FMD PCR positive samples. Only half of them were antigen ELISA positive. And that is what we often see. It's quite normal also for submissions to Purbright. And in Egypt, I've even seen that it's even much lower sometimes. And that has to do, of course, with sample quality. Yeah, the often outbreak investigations are late, remote areas, not early notifications. Especially samples from small ruminants, only small fragments or swabs, they tend to be negative in the antigen ELISA. And in this case, all these samples, the 45 of them, they were typed by this conventional PCR, whereas only half of them were typed by the antigen ELISA. So for them, as a frontline diagnostic, I think it is adding certainly something. And of course, the products can also be sequenced to know which Z2 or which A or whatever it is. I hope, well, it's highly recommended to continuously monitor the circulating strains by nucleotide sequencing to be sure that a developed assay stays fit for purpose. And I think that they are doing that nowadays, and every year, or sometimes twice a year, we have shipments of strains to Purbright and can keep a close eye on what is happening there, because Egypt is, for all sorts of reasons, a very interesting country, but also for FMD. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that's a very good presentation and a nice result. Labib, you have a question.
It is not a question, thank you for this presentation. It's just a comment and maybe small recommendation. We, as you say, we developed this kind of classical PCR for type in West Africa. But I think it is necessary to add at least the 3D detection, because imagine that you have a shift in parameters for typing, and you maybe you will use some OASA2.
That's a very good point, and in fact he has been doing that, but it was a bit too late to include it in the presentation.
Yeah.
But he's writing the manuscript now and making a combination with the PEN-FMD also.
Yeah. I know that it works very well. Yeah. The second point is what you said, that it's a cheaper, but also I know that many people use a kit for one-step classical PCR. So if you can have a mix of primers in the freezer adequate, and you can use the same master mix for classical PCR, that you can use it for other diseases. So people can buy master mix, and then what they need to perform any PCR, they just to take the mix of primers corresponding to the disease and do the PCR. And this is also another thing that can be maybe thinking for be cheaper for diagnosis.
Thank you very much, Labib.
Okay. Other questions? No.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Case was a good presentation.